you so much for your company this morning. And welcome, producer Alex. So you have got the pleasure of interviewing one of the biggest bands from the 90s. First up, you went to the UK to do it. How? Why? Why was I not invited?
Who was paying for the flight?
Okay, fair enough.
And I'm a massive fan.
You're a massive fan of this band, so much so that what did you take with you?
I took all my records for them to sign.
How many records did you have?
Actually, to be fair, I didn't take them all because that would have been stupid.
Oh, yeah.
I took about 10.
Oh, you took about 10.
Just the 10.
Just the 10.
This happened quite quickly, though, didn't it? It wasn't just, you didn't have months to prepare.
No, the publicist phoned me and said, hey, we can get an interview, we'll take that. It's tomorrow. Can you do it? And I said, well, obviously not, unless it's in Sydney.
Yeah.
And she said, no, it's going to be in the UK. And I said, I'd love to take that. Yeah, sure. But can we do it in a couple of days? So they managed to make it happen. And I literally got on a plane, flew to London, got on another plane, flew to Manchester, and arrived about an hour and a half before the interview.
Had you met them before?
Individually over the years, yes.
But not together? Were you like this? With your notes?
Ridiculous, yes.
So you arrived there for some sort of red carpet event, is it?
I didn't know it was a red carpet event, so it turns out they've done a musical, which is basically all their hits.
It's like a concert.
Set to dance. And so I knew we were doing this interview, it was on the roof of the Opera House in Manchester, and I thought, oh, that must be a handy location for where they are or something like that. Walked around the corner, people everywhere, red carpet, and I thought, hang on. This is for me? Surely not.
It's a little old producer from New Zealand.
No, I don't want to go on about it. But it turns out to be the opening night of their musical. So there's the red carpet. It's in Manchester, so pretty much everybody from Coronation Street's there.
Wow.
People everywhere.
Did you get a chance to see the musical?
No, I didn't.
Oh, no.
Did you walk up the red carpet going, I'm going to talk to them soon, I'm going to be interviewing Take That soon?
Well, it was a little bit like that because everyone was there because they are so famous there. That everyone was there to see them. And the other celebrities on the red carpet, that was just, oh yeah, whatever. They wanted to see Take That. And when Take That arrived, it was just chaos.
Oh my God, how exciting. Okay.
It was cool. And I was there waiting for the camera guy because they'd arranged a local Manchester guy. So there I was standing on the corner looking shifty. a cab pulls up and Graham Norton jumps out.
Oh.
So I thought, I'm going to say hello
because
it's not every day you get to chat to Graham Norton. So I went to say hello and managed to get a selfie with him, which initially he wasn't that into. And then he smiled for the selfie.
Good on you, Graham.
Which was nice.
Excellent.
And then he went in and everyone said, oh my gosh, it's Graham Norton. Because he was pretty famous.
Okay, let's hear what Take That had to say.
They burst onto the UK scene in 1990 and became one of the biggest bands of all time. 12 number one UK singles, 7 number one UK albums and sellout tours across stadiums. And then suddenly, not long after Robbie Williams announced he was leaving, the band called a press conference for the BBC. They were going to call it a day. I asked Gary, Mark and Howard how they felt.
It was a very, very strange moment, that press conference. I mean, for me personally, I wasn't actually ready for it. It was just it was the decision the old band and the majority of the band made. And it was, quite an emotional time in my life, that, you know, all splitting up. Because for me, that was what I knew. I had four brothers, you know, with me all the way for those 5-6 years. And it was just a beautiful time. It was a very fast time though. And I think that's probably one of the reasons why we decided what we had to do and go our own separate ways really. And that was why sort of the decision was made.
So why, at the height of their success, did they decide to split?
I think we had to do it because we joined the band so young. We'd not really ever experienced life without it. And I think we hadn't really, sort of matured into ourselves in many ways by the end of that first time. I don't think any of us really knew who we were.
Or spread our wings, really.
I think we started to learn about life after that, really.
Yeah. And I feel like I'd barely had an adult life by the time I was 25, because I'd worked since I was 11, played thousands and thousands of gigs before I joined Take That. So when I eventually was in the band when I was 19, it just felt like overnight, we went from playing schools and clubs to playing around the world. Yeah.
Then, after taking 10 years off, the fans got what they've been waiting for. Take That were coming back. So I asked the boys how it all came about and why they agreed to doing it again.
We found Mark in a skip, didn't we?
Yeah. I think we'd probably not the best. We'd gone out one evening, hadn't we, in London. And I think we'd been
drinking, hadn't we?
We've been drinking.
We've been drinking.
Yeah. To do with alcohol.
We've got a brilliant idea.
That's one of them. It was one of them.
And we phoned Jason, who was at a wedding or something somewhere. I can't remember where he was. And it was probably 11 o'clock at night. And we said, "Come to London now." And he came. And we all sort of met up in the 2 in the morning and said, "You know, what do you think? Could we do it?" And you know, we all put our hands and went,
yes, it was a bit. It felt quite reckless at the time. It felt like, what are we doing? But there was something in everyone's eyes that I noticed that night where just like it was intriguing to try again.
They reformed and were bigger than ever, breaking the record for the fastest selling concert of all time. Now older and wiser, I asked how they cope doing these big world tours now that they've all got kids.
Yeah, I think obviously when you talk about the world, when you start going around Europe and doing other countries away from the UK, that's when it does become tough. But you obviously your family comes first and you factor those into the equation really. And with the UK, that's quite easy. You take them around with you to different places, you stay in the hotels, and you know, the kids play with each other's kids, and it's a good laugh. But when you talk about, you know, the tour we're about to embark on, Australia and New Zealand, that's where it becomes difficult, where you're away for 3.5 weeks. So, but that's the way it is, and we really want to do that. And we've got very understanding wives, and they're really happy for what we do.
The amazing thing is, this time around, when we go to Australia, there's things like Skype and FaceTime, and telephones have been invented since the last time we toured around.
I might be exaggerating there a little bit.
And now Take That are coming to New Zealand for the first time, but I wanted to know if they've been here before.
I went to Auckland once for a promotion for an album in 98. It was a solo album, hugely successful around the world. And they're still talking about it, or maybe it's just me talking about it. It was called Open Road, I think. So I was there for a day. Right. I had a day in Auckland, I had a day in Rotorua, went sightseeing, and then I flew on after that. But
I'm very
stunning.
Excited. Sorry, guys.
Stunning.
I'm very excited to go to New Zealand. I got a friend from secondary school who emigrated there.
Have you?
Are you going to see them?
To Auckland, so I'm really excited to see him. He's a funny guy. All right, Chris.
Wow. Wow, great.
We're all going round to Chris's.
Yeah.
And finally, I wanted to know if they're looking forward to the laid-back Kiwi attitude and being able to walk down the street without being mobbed.
Well, we did wonder when we were offered the chance to play there if anyone would know us, if anyone would come to the show. So we're really delighted that people are actually coming.
And that was my time with Take That. Can't wait to see you in New Zealand, boys, when you get here.
Down to earth. That was a great chat.
They were actually really, really nice. Yeah. And I mean, we had about half an hour of actual just of chatting, and then it was all the photos and the selfies afterwards, because all the crew all of a sudden, Gary, can I have a selfie? Because he's so flipping famous.
Yeah. Mm. And we've got the chance for people to meet them as well and go along to the concert, right?
Yeah, I kind of sprung that on them and I said, so can we just record some liners? You know, we're going to be on the cafe tomorrow, stuff like that, and do one. And you can meet us backstage at the Auckland and Wellington show. So they did it. And then the manager came up and said, and I said, could we make that happen? So we have.
Excellent stuff.
Excellent.
So you can go along to our Facebook page and tell us why you're the biggest fan to be and to win if you'd like to win those meet and greet tickets. And if you don't want to miss out, make sure you get your tickets at ticketek.co.nz.
Awesome. I'm so glad they were nice, because imagine if they hadn't been nice.
I know. I was thinking.
How devastated you would have been.
Yeah, what if I turn up and they're horrible? But I checked with a couple of radio friends from the UK and said, you've interviewed them a million times. Is it worth coming? They said they never do a bad interview.
Awesome. Oh, yeah. Well done you.